rise. Please join me as we invite God and each other into our time of worship and praise as we join together in this unison call to worship. God of hope, we come into your presence this morning with confidence that you will meet us here. Where there is sadness, bring joy. Where there is tiredness, bring refreshment. Where there is despair, bring a renewed sense of hope. Let this place be a sanctuary, a safe haven for us, a home for holy words and songs and prayers as we devote ourselves to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now let us greet one another with the peace of Christ.
She said, I guess. I'm already in that. Amen. Thank you so much to our Wesley Choir. That was beautiful. We're grateful to God for them. Well, good morning. My name is Daniel Hilty. I'm one of the pastors here, and it's a joy to welcome you to our 11 o'clock worship service. This has been a beautiful weekend for a lot of reasons here at First United Methodist Church, not just the Wesley Choir and our Chancel Choir we'll hear later. Friday night was the Turkey Jam. Who here was present for the Turkey Jam? Yeah, we had a lot of fun for the Turkey Jam. It was a great time. Folks who gathered, you helped to contribute enough to buy over 50 meals for Thanksgiving meals for neighbors in need this Thanksgiving. So thank you so much for that. Also, this is the first weekend that we have our brand new overhead cross, and we are so grateful to God for that. It was appropriate that we start the service with Lift High the Cross. It just kind of seemed to be rightly sung. Many people made that possible. We're grateful to God for each of them, including memorial funds from Dave Donnelly, and we're grateful to the Donnelly family for that. Lastly, you're here, and man, what a joy it is to have you here, especially if you are a visitor. Thank you so much for including worship at First United Methodist Church as part of your day. We hope that somehow you have a sense of God's love for you and Jesus' love for you and our love for you. You're always welcome, and I hope to see you back here again. It's now time that we pause to dismiss our children for children's worship. So right here by the back door is our family minister, Sherry Baltzer. She's waving. Children, please go with Sherry. She will take you to a family ministry center. Parents, grandparents, please sign them out if you haven't done already. There are puppets in children's worship today. So you don't want to miss it. It should be a wonderful blessing and a great gift. Thank you, Sherry. Thank you, children. Will you please join with me in praying a blessing upon them? Oh God, we give you thanks for your children. We give you thanks for these, your sons and daughters. We pray your blessings upon them as they worship, that your love may shine in and through them. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you.
As we enter into our scripture for today, I wonder, what treasure cost you a lot of effort to acquire? What lengths did you go to get it? Was it worth it? From the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 13, verses 44 and 45. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then, in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of the pearls, of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Keith Fessa, I'm one of the pastors here on staff. It is a pleasure to be in worship with you. I know that Daniel welcomed you if you were a guest this morning. I also want to have a special word of welcome to you, as well as those watching on television and on the internet. You are a part of this worship service, and I hope that whatever brought you here today and whatever means that you feel God at work in your life. Well, we are in our final week of a Curious Minds series. in which we've been emphasizing the parables of Jesus Christ. And probably no other parables in the whole series of parables hits home more to the imagination of the disciples than the two really short parables of today. In one, we have the kingdom of heaven, right? The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure. And in the other, we have the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant. And if we looked at sort of the context of what's happening during the time of these two scriptures, these two parables, every village has a story of a man who all of a sudden becomes rich by finding treasure during this time. Because what would happen is during war or times of turmoil, people, you know, they didn't have a bank or a safety deposit box or a safe to put their stuff in, so they would just bury it. They would bury their valuables and try to come back at a later time to recover them. So on the flip side of what was happening is then the people would buy land in hopes of finding literally buried treasure. So people would store what they had, come back, but sometimes they'd come back to somebody else owning that land and having already uncovered the treasure. So during this time, there is this expectation of finding treasure. And if you would go to a town and you would see somebody, you know, sort of rummaging through the turmoil and the ruins of a town, you knew what they were doing. They were looking for someone's buried treasure. And I think that fantasy holds true today for some of us. The fantasy of finding hidden treasure. And when I was a kid, I grew up on a farm. I always kind of thought, you know, that an old barn or somewhere in the field, I was going to find something too, right? That I would find a bit of hidden treasure. And even when I was younger, I thought at the end of the rainbow, certainly there was gold at the end of that rainbow. Where's that rainbow at? And when I got older, I see a lot of folks sometimes think they're going to discover something grand at a garage sale, right? That $1 picture that you buy, really behind it is that lost Monet or Van Gogh that has yet to be discovered and will be worth millions of dollars. Or sometimes it's that family heirloom on the Antique Roadshow on PBS, right? That was great-great-grandma's and you've been holding it dear and your dream is that maybe it's worth, you know, worth more than just sentimental value. So in a weird way, this idea that we can discover treasure still holds true for us today. And even though it may be unrealistic, it's something we haven't given up. And I think one of the reasons we haven't given up is because from time to time, somebody finds something. Or at least we hear the story of, you know, and from time to time that somebody finds something. And so we think that maybe, you know, just maybe we have an opportunity to find a treasure as well. You know, it hasn't been that long ago that a shepherd boy near the Dead Sea found the Dead Sea Scrolls, missing for 2,000 years, and here they were discovered. And it hasn't been that long ago that there was a farmer in Suffolk, England, who struck a container, and he found that it held silver plates that dated all the way back to the Roman Empire. And it hasn't been that long ago that there was a diver off the Florida coast who found a 17th century Spanish ship that had been sunk and found silver and gold. So while it's not probable that we find it, it happens just enough for us to sort of still hold out a little hope that treasures will still be discovered in our lifetime. And maybe that we will be one of the people to discover them. And for some reason, for some people, that desire to discover becomes an obsession. For some, we focus all our energy on that one thing, and we start thinking that we will be able to put a lot of effort into that one thing, and that the reward for that effort will be worth it. All the effort we put into something, whatever that passion is, whatever our desire is, whatever our obsession becomes, will be well worth it. Naturally, there's a TV show for folks who have sort of single-mindedness. And it's on the Learning Channel. It's called My Crazy Obsession. And My Crazy Obsession follows folks whose desires for objects have turned into an obsession. And what I learned from watching some of these this week is that the process kind of reveals the effort it requires to maintain one's passion. You may not agree with some of the passions that are on this show, but you can see that they put a lot of time and effort to become the best in their certain area. Like Barry Levinson heard a voice one day that told him to collect mustard. Yes, mustard. That's a lot of mustard. Two jars, I'm good. I don't need all that mustard. But Tamas, she collects wigs, and she has over 2,000 wigs in her collection. That's what she focuses her passion on. And I hope I'm not being rude, but I'm really hoping she's wearing one of them right now. I'm hoping that's something she's showing off. Ron, he has an extensive collection of bobbleheads, presidential bobblehead dolls. And that's what he puts his energy and passion around. So I found it interesting what people will put, you know, all of their passion into. What will be their one thing that someone believes in greatly, that they will put a lot of effort into, that they will set aside other things in their life to focus on, and that the reward is so great for them that they put their passion into it. So even in a weird way, that these folks, they were kind of successful, right? I mean, he probably has the best mustard collection, right? Ron probably has the best bobblehead president collection that there is. So I've been kind of inspired by that, and I think that I'm going to start collecting the Methodist founder John Wesley bobbleheads. And because what a better way, right, to honor our heritage than to collect, a bobblehead doll. But what I found, again, is that when you focus on one thing, even in a twisted way, you can become successful. Even like in our movie clip from Wallace and Gromit. Is anybody familiar with Wallace and Gromit? Yeah, there's a few folks. This half-hour movie was called The Wrong Trousers. And in this movie, you have the penguin that was disguised as a chicken, successfully stealing a diamond. Right, after months, perhaps years of planning and focusing on one thing, one large goal that probably had smaller one things, right? He sort of focused on one thing and then the next thing and then the next thing to where he had a big plan to steal this diamond. And the thing I like about the clip is that even though we have a lot of energy focused on one thing, it doesn't guarantee that everything is going to go perfect. It may increase the odds that we'd be successful, but it doesn't guarantee that it'll go exactly as planned, right? In the video, adjustments had to be made as Wallace woke up and sort of started messing with and set off the alarm. And adjustments sometimes have to be made even though we have planned everything out. So focusing on one thing doesn't guarantee success, but I think it increases the odds. And that seems like a fair shake to me. Gary Keeler talks about this kind of singular focus in his book, and it's up on the screen so you can already guess what it's called, right? It's called The One Thing. And Gary is the co-founder of the largest real estate company in America. And from the title, you may think that his one thing is about real estate. But as you read it, you find that really his book is about many one things, and that can be a little confusing. But for example, he has one main thing that he focuses on in his work, and one main thing in his personal life, and sort of one main thing in how he deals with personal relationships. So really what it ends up being is that Gary is trying to increase the odds of what he will be successful at by taking his energy that may be on 50 things and narrowing it down to like 5. And within that boundary of those one things, he asks one question that I thought was very good, very interesting. He asks, what's the one thing you can do such that by doing it, everything else will be easier or unnecessary? What's the one thing we can do to where by doing it, everything else will be easier or unnecessary? So, you know, we may end up asking ourselves questions like, you know, what's the one thing I can do today to ensure that I'm going to get to the gym? Or what's the one thing I can do today to help my team succeed? Or what's the one thing I can do to improve the relationship with my partner? And that requires us making choices. That's sort of what Gary is getting at for us. Because we have so many responsibilities nowadays, and it's hard to balance all this stuff. And you know, how do I focus? You know, how do I choose? What can I drop? You know, how do I get from 50 things that are spinning around in my mind down to 5. And surprisingly, Gary gives us some insight of something that I would never have guessed. He says, One of the first things you can do is get rid of something. And what he's saying is, stop the pursuit of a balanced life. Stop pursuing having a balanced life. He says that's an idea. It's not realistic. You know, the concept that we can have sort of this balance between work and home, or we can have balance between what we're passionate about and our day-to-day tasks. He says that the act of living a full life by giving time to what matters is more important. Because giving equal time to all things that we deem important is not attainable. And as I thought about that, I had to agree with him, because I hear a lot of people talking about finding the balanced life, but I don't hear a lot of people telling me that they've attained the balanced life. And Gary says that a balanced life is a lie. It's not realistic. What is realistic is living a full life by giving time to what matters. And that may lead to tough choices for us. The problem being that, you know, being balanced is that when you tend to all things, you end up shortchanging all things. Really, what he's talking about is purpose, meaning, and significance are the things that make a successful life, not balance. Purpose, meaning, and significance are the things that we should focus on. So maybe when it comes to a balanced life, we are really just expending energy for something that doesn't exist. And the author is giving us permission to stop that, to let that one go. And if we let all of our energy that we put into that go, then maybe we have energy for questions like, what is the one thing I can do to help someone else? What is the one thing I can do to improve my relationship with God? What is the one thing I can do to introduce someone to Jesus Christ? And I raise those kind of questions because our parables today are telling us that the reality of the kingdom of God should elicit a single-minded response. Whether discovery is like the parable one, and we intentionally are searching for the kingdom of God, or whether we are like parable two and the discovery of the kingdom of God is surprise, either way that you get there, any way that you've encountered God should point us to making that relationship our one thing. So if the parables tell us that focusing on the kingdom of God is our one thing that we should devote our time to, for me, that's too big of a thing. It's just too large. It's kind of nebulous for me. So I needed to break that down a little bit as I thought about this. And for me, having goals helps, because in my previous life, I was a certified project manager. So for me, I am just wired to think of what's my someday long-term goal, and then breaking that down. So I start with my someday goal of being, you know, fully encountered with all my heart in loving God, right? Fully encountered, fully engaged with the kingdom of God. If that's my someday plan, then I break that down into maybe what are my 5-year goals for my someday plan. And those for you could be, you know, they could be daily prayer life, they could be tithe, they could be direct engagement with people who need your assistance. They could be deeper and more regular worship. They could mean having a deeper understanding of theology. There's a wide variety of sort of what is that one thing that I could focus on. And then you work your way down. For me, I work my way down to a today goal, and it becomes kind of this domino effect of from my someday goal to a 5-year goal to a 1-year goal to a now goal. A bit of warning, though, when you begin focusing on your one thing, you will discover that you have to time block. And that may mean scheduling it on your calendars by setting aside time. It may mean setting aside time each day. It may be setting aside certain days of the week. It may be setting aside certain weeks of the year where you're going to give extra time to the thing that's your passion. And it may mean letting go of other things. And one of the things that I've been struggling with the last few weeks is that may mean letting go of trying to do everything perfect. I kind of grew up in that, you know, if it's worth doing, it's worth doing well. That's kind of, and Gary's saying, sometimes not everything is worth doing perfectly. Sometimes it's just worth doing well. And putting your energy and your passion and your gifts in your areas that will command success is where you should be focusing. Now, for others of you, you may be wired differently than me, and you may say, well, this goal, the someday goal of being in full connection with God is too big for me to think about. So you really just need to sort of take one bite off the elephant, right? You just need to sort of have one step forward, and maybe you're going to attack it that way. Because sometimes things are so daunting that we just need to start. We just need to take that one step. And that's okay, too. That's a good way to approach it. So for us to reach the someday goal of being fully engaged with the kingdom of God while on earth, it really comes down to intentionality. However you want to approach that goal, it comes down to intentionality. And repeating the question, what's the one thing that you can do that by doing it, everything else will be easier or unnecessary? And I want us to walk that talk a little bit today. Everyone should have been given a note card and an envelope and a little pencil. And there's a Ryan under you's a basket for the choir to get a pencil and an envelope and a card. And Paul's going to come up and play here in a minute a song that he wrote, by the way, that is so wonderful that I asked him to come back and play it because it just touched my heart. And we're going to take a few minutes, and I would like everyone to think about what's the one thing that you can do today or tomorrow? It doesn't have to be something grand. What's the one thing you can do to move closer to being in connection with God and Jesus Christ? And nobody's going to see these. During offering, I'm going to ask you for them to be collected, and what's going to happen with them is they're not going to ever be open. This is between you and God. And I am going to collect them all, and I'm going to pray over them every day this week for you. And when we do staff prayer time this week and we come together as a staff and pray for everybody here and for ourselves, I'm going to bring those with me too, and we're going to pray over them there too. So let's take a few minutes and think about that one thing that you can do to draw closer to God. And this week I'll pray over them, and maybe this week you'll pray over them. And you'll be one step closer to being in relationship, a deep relationship with Jesus Christ.
Begins with one footstep, and a thousand more will follow close behind. And it's time I started walking back your way, 'cause you're too far from this heart of mine. The sun on the horizon, an evening star shines through. A thousand more will light a lonely night. But my heart's a thousand pieces scattered across the floor. But we'll pick it up one piece at a time. You're the one thing that I need. You're my treasure, you're my pearl. With tender touch, you soothe my troubled mind. But once again, I'm stranded like a thousand times before. 'cause you're too far from this heart of mine. Treasure, you're my pearl. With tender touch, you soothe my troubled mind. And once again, I'm stranded like a thousand times before. 'Cause you're too far from my heart of mine. I've searched the world for riches, a thousand debts to show. With empty hands I threw my pearl to swine. And I feel so helpless, but I've cried my last tear. 'Cause you are always in this heart of mine.
Thank you so much, Paul and Robin, for playing again. I dragged them back here. I just thought that's wonderfully played and wonderfully sung and wonderfully written. I know that Daniel at the 9 o'clock, he said it so well about worship, you know, over thousands of years changes, but the one thing that has stayed steady is the celebration of the Eucharist, the coming to the table, the sharing of the meal, and because this is kind of the one way that we have as Christians to experience that meal together, to experience that last meal of Jesus Christ. So I invite you all to join together in our litany and our liturgy for today. It's on page 13 and 14 of your hymnal. It'll also be on the screens. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, 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 holy Lord,
God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, you delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and you made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. So we remember how on that night in which he first gave himself up for us, Christ took bread, and he gave thanks to you, O God. And he broke the bread, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body that is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, when the supper was over, Christ took the cup, and he gave thanks to you, Almighty God, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant that is poured out for you and for so many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so it is in remembrance of all of these God's mighty acts in Jesus Christ that we offer ourselves this morning as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as together we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, O God, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes again and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And all the people say,
Amen.
Amen. I'd like to invite those who are helping with communion to please come forward.
And as they do, I invite us all to join together with the confidence of children of God as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us praying. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
There are instructions about communion on the back of your bulletin, but please know that you are welcome and you are invited. As the ushers dismiss us, we're going to begin with the choir. Following the choir, will you come at the ushers' leading to the Lord's feast?
Thank you.
In communion, Christ offers himself to us, and we offer ourselves back. There are other ways that we offer ourselves as well, both through prayer and through offering. Before our offering, I invite us to join together in a moment of prayer as we lift to God concerns, joys of our congregation. Let us pray. Oh God, we give you thanks for this sacred meal, this holy mystery in which you give yourself to us abundantly. You are, oh God, our greatest treasure. You are that pearl that is beyond price. And we pray that you would help us to desire you above all else. This morning, oh God, we pray for the riches of your grace, the abundance of your promise, that treasure especially for those whom we lift to you in our hearts, for those who are facing violence or hurt or war. We pray for peace in lands like Syria and Iraq and Kenya this week, for those affected by storms in the Northeast. We lift to you your children, our neighbors around this community, around this state, in Ferguson, and right here in Jefferson City. We pray for each one who is gathered here today, O Lord, that you would indeed move in us and among us. Especially this morning, O God, we pray for the family and friends of two dear saints of this church, Diana Cox and Charles Walton, whom you have received into your presence this week. Comfort their loved ones who grieve, O God, and make us all instruments of your comfort and peace. We pray all these things through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're invited to make an offering of ourselves this morning through our giving as well. In just a moment, the ushers will come forward. If you're visiting today, we don't ask you or expect you to give. It is a gift just to have you here. As a reminder, for those of you who don't carry cash or checks, like I don't, you're welcome to use the QR code on your attendance card to scan and give with your smartphone as well. Also, we invite us to please place our attendance cards in the baskets as they are passed. Let us worship God by giving of ourselves. Let us pray. O God, receive these gifts as a sign of our thanksgiving and gratitude. Bless and use them for the work of Jesus Christ, through whom we pray. Amen. Before our closing hymn, I want to say I hope you'll be back next week. Next week, we are starting our new series, which we're just calling Christmas at First, because really, how can you just improve on getting ready for Christmas? So Christmas at First starts next week as the Advent season is upon us, preparing for the birth of Jesus Christ on Christmas Day. Hope you'll be here for that. I was also going to let you know on the next slide that one way we can prepare is to stop by the tree in the lobby on the far side. We have adopted three families that we have gotten to know and have a personal relationship with through Common Ground, our community center, who are in special need. And there was a whole range of gifts that we could give, ranging from bars of soap up to a bed for a single mom and two daughters who only had one bed between all three of them. So I was going to tell you to stop by the tree and to get a gift and sign your name and take a tag. But I love this church so much. Do you know that tree was stripped bare after the 9 o'clock service? So stay tuned. We're going to find other ways that you can give. In the meantime, though, thank the Lord. Thank God for the generous hearts and amazing compassion of Christ that you, this congregation, embodies. For now, however, as we remain standing, let us join together in our closing hymn. It is number 528 in the hymnals, and it's also on the screen, Nearer My God to Thee.
We have met for worship. Now let us go forth to witness. We have met to hear the word of God. Let us go forth to share that word. And you have met as God's people. Let us go forth as Christ's body. Amen. And go in peace.